than any hindrances. And you are great in me, for me, through me. And I give you praise for your presence in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, when we worship, I feel the worship magnifies the Lord. Feel the worship magnifies the Lord. That's why we worship, and then suddenly He's greater than anything that was trying to be bigger than Him in your life. Worship puts Him in the position that He already has. So as you worship Him and He's lifted up, then every hindrance starts just come tumbling down. That's why the enemy is so calm against our worshiping. He comes even in your home. He'll do everything to stop you from worshiping. If you be busy with this, be busy with that. Everything. Because the moment you worship Him, the enemy cannot be there, because he cannot be in that realm. He's been kicked out of it. All right. So we worship the Lord. You just have to sing a little hallelujah every now and then. If you have to crawl to the play button, the play button on the, you have to crawl there because of the hindrances. New Wednesday night people, you're just pressing through. I love Wednesday nights. You guys are thirsty, hungry. I want to read a story I was reminded of as we were drawing nigh unto Him. Wow. I'll be reading, you guys can. But let's start at verse 7 of John chapter 4. And we read, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. She comes to draw water. Nancy and Tanya and Claudia, they just go to the library with their two little sandwiches. You go to your work and you just go to do what you do every day. You come to a Wednesday night service and you think, hey, service as usual. Oh, I just love encounters with the Spirit of the living God. I just love, I just delight the way that He surprises us. I just feel that His very life is to bring things that we don't expect. I like the unexpected. I've always kind of been a little bit adventurous. You know, when I was growing up in France, and if somebody said, hey, they have a tunnel under the school, I wanted to go see what was in there. It was adventurous. I wanted, you know. You go to the wood, you know, because there's no TV, nothing. You grow up and, you know, you just learn to explore. I wanted to go. I wanted to see. I like spontaneous things. I had this thing that I would do with the girls, you know, at home. Is we had this thing that sometimes I would come home, it wasn't planned, nothing, and I would say, it's surprise time, we're going to the movie. And they would look at me and say, I said, now. And we just go to the movies, just like that. Because sometimes you make plans and I won't talk about. But here comes Jesus, and this woman of Samaria, she came to draw water like she does so often. You remember someone else that did that is Rebecca. She met Isaac. Makes you think, you know, when you go get water at Safeway, hey. Because you never know. You're a child of God. You have divine appointments everywhere you go. The Holy Spirit, we're learning to recognize He's a person, and we need to recognize even His presence and who He is even between us. You know, we need to learn never to look at one another in the natural, but in the spirit. You know, we need to learn to even be able to make the difference when we feel any opposition to what you know is in a person, the Christ in them, the life of God. And you need to know how to just draw from the Lord and help them draw it out. Whew. The worship draws it. And did I read the passage or did I stop? Oh. She was drawing water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for His disciple had gone away into the city to buy food. What do you mean, Jesus? You just multiplied food for thousands of people. You're able to do a miracle, but when it comes to you, you hungry? You thirsty? I mean, you know, you just multiplied all this bread. You know, you think, hey, French baguette, come down. Filet mignon, now. In Jesus' name. Big potato, stack. Even the enemy told him, if you are the Son of God, and you know, just command those stones to be turned into bread. But you see, our master doesn't use his miraculous powers for himself because he's not self-centered. You see, the great mighty God that we serve, he sent the disciples to get him food, and he doesn't use, because he knows that what he has is not for himself. He's used not to go to Father to say, give me this, give me that, but oh, what is it that they need? And when our focus is on what other people need, and we open to the Spirit of the living God, there's greater miracles than you can even think. But you know, when it's for you, you know. Cadillac in my driveway now. A red one. The black thing and the other thing and the third. And I'm being warm now. Come on, 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 come on. I'm sorry. And he said, no. Just a little detail. I'm just flowing with the Holy Ghost. She talks about the little thing. But he says to her, give me to drink. It's like, but Jesus, she's here to draw water. You're asking her to give you what she didn't get yet. Jesus, you're asking her, don't you know she's a woman from Samaria? Jesus, it looks pretty bad. You're going to have Charisma magazine talk about you. It looks pretty bad. Your reputation is not gonna last long. You're asking this total stranger from Samaria to give you something to drink. You better hurry up before the disciples come and they see you talk. to this person, you're not allowed to. And then the woman of Samaria, she said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? See, for Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. So not only you're not doing a miracle for yourself, but I love how Jesus, he always heals on the Sabbath. He always breaks religious stronghold. He always comes against legalism. He always has a way to show, now listen, I'm not going to make a difference with what you used to see in the natural. I come and I make no difference. I'm not going to go by your prejudice background. I'm going to come because of what the Lord has for you. It doesn't matter what you look like. It doesn't matter that you're Samaritan. I can receive water from you because you need what I have, but I just want to kind of draw you near to me. When we have a need and we pay attention to the working of the Holy Spirit, oftentimes you will be tested to see if you will walk in the limitless of God. If you will press through and pay attention to those that nobody else pays attention to. If you would be willing to go on the highways and the byways when no one else goes, if you would be just willing that this neighbor that's been living next to you for since 1915, that you would ask the Lord, what do you want me to do with him? And Jesus answered and he said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Wow. It's like if you were able not to see me in the natural and not to see me as a Jew, but if you would be able to see what is not seen and hear what is not heard, then you would understand that what I have is greater, but I'm asking you for a drink because what I want is really not the drink, it's your heart. Because I'm not after what you can do for me. I'm after the transformation that this living water can bring. The Lord, he says, if you knew the gift of God, and when I see each and everyone here tonight, and when I see you in the spirit, I see the gift of God that you carry, that you are. I see the living water that's stirring in you, and I see the enemy oftentimes just crushing people and making them not pay attention to the gift. The gift, the precious living waters, that it's never about what's material, what can be seen. It's never about the natural need that we need. Never. It's always about what we carry, that we have for someone, for some place, for something around us. It's always for more than we can see. And it will be hindered and it will be battled every step that you go. The enemy will make you think you have no water. The enemy will make you think you are dry. The enemy will make you think you have nothing to give. But you already have received the greatest gift of all. You already have received the greatest gift of all. You have the gift of God. You have living water. You come to him and drink so that living water can just be stirred up everywhere you go. You are a precious gift, my friends. If you would see the gift that you are, every time the enemy battle you, you would be able to just rise up and say, no, I know who I belong to. I know what the Holy Spirit is giving me. I will obey him. The precious Holy Spirit, we've been saying these past messages or whenever, that he gets quenched, he gets grieved. He gets grieved when he's ignored.
it gets quenched. The Bible tells us do not despise prophecies, do not quench the spirit, do not extinguish it. And he says, hold fast, hold on to what it's good. He said, do not resist the Holy Spirit. But now what is the opposite of those three things that grieve and quench and resist the Holy Spirit? Well, there's also some things that do the opposite. Like when you believe, oh, no wonder God says he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him, because he who believes that he is. There's something that happens when the Holy Spirit, he knows that you believe he's here. And you pay attention to him, not just in your life and not just what he's doing in your life, but Holy Spirit, what am I doing to you? Am I helping you or am I hindering you? Whoa. What am I doing to you? Now I'll take it another step further among one another. Holy Spirit, what are you doing in their life? How he's pleased when he's honored. Not just believed, but believed that he's here and honored and respected. When we pay attention to one another, not just people at a library or that we meet, but to one another. When we believe and we respect him and we know that he's working. And we take the time, you know, to be still and know that he is God. It takes a whole different level when you learn to flow with the Holy Spirit, because then you learn that the moment that you still, that you remain still and you just stop and try to pay attention. That's when he drops something. That's when he drops a word. That's when you can pay attention and be still enough and to see, oh, no, Lord, you're talking to that person. It's not the right time for me to say, oh, I see them weeping. I'm going to leave them alone. Oh, I detect that there's a battle in their heart, but I think I'm supposed to pray against that before I talk to them. Oh, precious Holy Spirit, the moment that you steal, there's a flow, because the river starts flowing the moment that you steal. The more you try to think and do, then the waters are still. But the more you steal, the more the waters are stirred up. Says, oh, if you knew the gift of God, you would ask me. You know, we come here, I pray, because we're so thirsty, hungry, desperate. To be so stirred up in our spirit that we can give a drink to someone. The Lord says, if you have not given me anything to drink, he said in another parable, and they said, well, how? What do you mean? He said, if you do it to the least of them, you do it as unto me. What do we have to pay attention to around us in our lives so that we can be so in tune with the Holy Spirit? When we believe in him, he's pleased. When we respect him, he's pleased. Here on the prayer line and even in your home and even in any places, when you respect that he's working, then he works more. When he's honored, he moves more. When he's welcome, he's just like, whoa. The more you appreciate and respect and honor his presence, the more he reveals himself to you in greater ways. The Holy Spirit is here to reveal the Son in, to, and through you. Yeah. And all the battles that we go through often come because there's greater revelation in and through you than you can see. It's when you don't know somebody's drinking from the living water through you that you will hear the lie that you don't have any water. It's when you hear the lie that your prayers are not availing too much. That someone you prayed for is walking in healing and victory. It's when you hear the lie that the Lord is not bringing forth the breakthrough that you have believed was coming, that it's closer than you think. It's when you get tuned in to what the Lord already has said he could do, that he can do more. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Woo! I'm starting to hear this song. draw me, Lord. I come running after thee. Woo! The scripture says that you draw nigh unto God, and he draw nigh unto you. Drawing nigh unto him doesn't mean when I go to him and I say, give me a drink, give me money for my beers, give me this, give me that. That's not drawing nigh to him. It's when I know that his life, it's when I know that in him I move and I have my being, is when I draw nigh as close as I can to rivers that will overtake me in the midst of a world where I get dry, where I get sad, I get grieved, because then I see things that are grieving. It's when I learn to what's grieving to him, and I learn what's affected him. And I want to draw nigh so close to him that the place that I feel in this river, and the river is in me by his grace, mind you, not because we deserve it, but because of everything that he already has done. And by this incredible, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that I can come boldly and I can just rest at his feet and be still and know that he is God, and be still that I can get so close that everything that comes around me to quench me can come to nothing. Wow. So the moment you draw nigh unto him, the moment like you came here tonight, when you started singing, and you're just pursuing the manifestation of his glory to another level. You're just pursuing him. You're desperate for a drink. You're desperate. You don't want to go dry. You don't want to be in this dry and thirsty land when there is no water. You thirst for him. You know that tomorrow you will need water, but you need him now. Not what you need in the natural, but if you can just be the thirsty and drawing nigh of everything that he represents, then oh my, the moment that you do one step, it's like, you know, when the prodigal son, the moment he got out of the pig pen and he thought, oh, whew, maybe I can just be a servant in my father's house. Are you kidding? The father every day was like, is it today? Is it today my son is going to be saved? Is it today my daughter is going to be free? Is my grandchild coming home today? He was looking. The moment that he saw his son, whoo, he got out of the house. And he ran after him. Oh, I love the visual. You know, it's not like Father is like, come on, draw nigh. I mean, come on, make a little bit of more of an effort. Come on, no. Give me 20 more. Hallelujah. Come on, swim. No. The moment that in your heart he sees you drawing nigh, then you might just do just this tiny bit. And the Lord, you know, he's like, doesn't he? It's nothing like his presence. Nothing like his presence. He wants us to remind ourselves. To remind ourselves that the Lord is there. How do you draw nigh when you're in your job and everything around you is just pulling that water? You're saying, Pastor, are you kidding? That they don't want the living water I carry. They actually try to quench me and just dry it out. And I can go to work just all filled up like, hey, I get the drink. Anybody want a drink? And with every word, every look, the more the day go by, the more they pull, the more they drain me. They don't want this water. They drain me. The enemy is using them to quench it. The enemy is using them to quench it. If you go to your work tomorrow morning and say, hey, I went to church last night, and let me tell you, I'm carrying the gift of God. I am filled with the living water. Hey, go get a cup. Somebody would call human resources. Somebody would say, hey, that person came to work a little bit intoxicated. Like, woo, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. There is something about drawing nigh quickly when you don't have much time. When I used to work at the lawyer's office, I used to go to the bathroom, and I used to just quickly say, Jesus. Jesus, I believe you are with me. I honor your presence. You see what's happening around me. I drink of you. I receive you. Now I receive your love, your peace, your joy. Whew. See you on the next break. And then I would go back. Then I would go back, and don't get me wrong, it was not always easy. It was a battle. But the more I became aware of his presence, the more I started believing him, honoring him, respecting him. And then at the same time, respecting what he was doing in others, even though I couldn't see it. There was this person I know was always just coming against God and cursing and doing all these things. One day, Father says, because I was saying, Lord, and I'm in the midst of unbelievers and these people. And the Lord one day said, how do you know? Said, how do you know that this person is going to remain an unbeliever? How do you know? No, I don't. I'm just saying. How do you know? And it changed the way that I started seeing people. Because I started being aware of the work of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And I sure, the way that I was feeling quenched, I sure didn't want to be the one quenching him, either in my life or working in the life of others. And so I started praying for them. I started praying for them without them knowing that I was praying. Hallelujah. I started paying attention to the work that the precious Holy Spirit was doing. It wasn't always easy. But now I look back now, and it's not that we come up with any formulas to do this, that, and that. No, we learn to draw nigh unto Him in every situation. But oh, the precious Lord, we take a half a step and it takes 20. Have you noticed when you need peace, how quickly you reach for peace by faith and peace just overtake you? Have you noticed how God doesn't even give you things? The gift of God is so huge that He doesn't just give you like a little peace and say, okay, take this for now. When God gives you peace, it's 100% peace. It's powerful. It's all of it. Whoo! Well, when He gives you love, and you just feel that shower of love, and you just feel like, whoo! He doesn't give you just a little bit. He's the greatest gift of all. Amen. Did I finish the story? I did. Precious Holy Spirit, if you knew the gift of God, He said, and who it is who said to you, give me a drink, you would have asked Him and He would have given you living water. And the woman said to Him, looking at the natural, she said, sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Said, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his son and his livestock? And Jesus could have answered, and He could have said, yes, I am the I am. Don't you love the Lord? He's got a way to do things that I'm just like, so in awe with the Lord. He doesn't do things, you know, like we would. You know, in this whole story, He brings no attention, no glory to Himself whatsoever. He talks in a mystery to her, knowing that actually He's drawing her in. And Jesus answered and He said to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him, in you. Not become, but is now. Look. It says, we'll become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. Whoa! I'm sure glad I came to draw water today, Jesus. Encounter like never before. And the woman, that's what she said, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst nor come here to draw. I'm tired of the same old, give me something that I don't have to get up tomorrow morning, go to the same place, eat, sleep, get up and do it again. Give me something that's going to take me out of the normal into the supernatural. Get me something that's going to just stir up my life like never before. Give me something that's going to take me out of the things that surround me. Give me something that I don't have to come here and draw water again, because I'm tired of sick. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm tired of getting up every morning and go through the same thing again and again and again and again. Bring me something that will change my life, stir up my life, transform my life. Give me something that I will be able to make a difference. Give me this water that will bring forth in me everlasting life. That's what I want. I don't like my life. I want this everlasting life, Jesus. Whoo! My God. And Jesus said to her, go call your husband. See, I'm telling you, Jesus is like totally cool. He's so awesome. He's so amazing. Now go get your husband. And go get your husband and come here. And the woman answered and she said, I have no husband. Man, you tell me you have water or everlasting and stuff. Is that like a demand? Like, do I need a husband to get a drink from you? What do you mean, go get a husband? What happened to, well, I'll give you this water, you never thirst again. What do you mean, where is your husband? If the Lord ever told you something that you were like, what has that got to do with where? You know my situation, you know what I'm going through, you know what I mean, fasting, interceding, and just praying day and night. You know, Lord. And the Lord comes up with some, where is your husband? Go get him. She said, I don't have one. She probably said that really sad, you know, like, well, there goes my luck again. I have no husband. And he said to her, you have well said, I have no husband. What do you mean? You already know and you asked me to go get the one you knew I didn't have? Jesus, he always asks questions that he knows the answer. I just heard the music. Well, I'm going to go to the thing. And the woman answered and she said, I have no husband. He said, you have said, well, I have no husband. He said, and then now he turned the whole story upside down. Now suddenly he goes from go get your husband to you have five. He said you have had five husbands. And now he's reading his whole life, his whole mail. The whole thing. He's like, you have had five, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. So by then, now she's really like, I'm really in trouble now. I really thought I had hit the jackpot. I thought, man, living water, everlasting life. And you know what Jesus said? That's why I love the Lord. That's why you have to pay attention everywhere you go, because Jesus comes to give us life. He uses your life in the people around where you are to bring forth his life. Jesus didn't start having a whole conversation like, well, how come you got divorced 5 times? Well, what didn't work with number one? Now tell me. Well, what happened to number two? Hold on, let me make some notes and see if I hear any word of wisdom. Tell me about number three. Come on. Then what happened about number four? Why did you ever try the fifth time? And now? You gave up on marriage and now you're just living with somebody? He didn't do that. You know why? Because he said, you spoke truly. And the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. No kidding. Hallelujah, you got it. And he says, And she says, our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and you Jews said that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. And Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, on September 10, 2014. Where the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. And the woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. And now Jesus, after all this, now he says, oh Lord, I wish I was there to hear your voice. At that very moment, can you just hear the Lord? And he says, I think it was like, you know, with the breath, you know, like the, you know, in the Hebrew, it's the, he said, I who speak to you, I am he. And at that moment, the disciples came and they marveled that he talked with a woman. They yet no one say, what do you seek or why are you talking to her? And then the greatest part is that then the woman, then she left her water pot, went away into the city and said to the man, come. See a man who told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Could this be the Christ? He told her he was he. She left the thing that she carried to fill with water. She left it. Because the moment that he said that to her, this woman received something that nothing else could have brought her. Forget five husbands, 50, 500 could not give her what she just met. She could not have looked for here or for there for anything that she just received. She didn't leave her water, she left her water pot because she would need it anymore. Hallelujah. She would never thirst again. She had an encounter, with Christ. And then from that point on, she started just knowing how to draw nigh and tell other people, come, come, come and see. And tonight, I pray that as you've been drawing nigh unto him because you came here, I don't know about you, but I feel like, whew. So everybody, we're gonna take a drink. Might become happy hour in the spirit. We're gonna take a drink. Think of all your needs, everything that's going on in your life right now. Think of every trial, heartache, every situation right now. And by faith, as you're taking a drink, you're receiving his very life, his very peace, his very ability. The Lord will show you what to leave. Sometimes we trust more in our water pot than we should. There might be a few water pots left on the altar tonight. Might be a few situation left on the altar. Can you do draw me? Lift up your hands and let's, as we worship, draw me. And as we have drawn him, I hear the Spirit of the Lord says, tonight I'm going to just completely quench your thirst. Because I have heard your cry and I've seen your heart, and it's not to quench me, it's not to grieve me. You have the heart that desire to please me. And there's been many things that have happened to come and quench the Spirit. Quench me in and through you. But the Lord says that we'll be no longer, because I'm increasing. I'm the one that's going to quench your thirst tonight, and the gift that you carry is going to be released in an increased measure everywhere you go. The Lord says, don't look at what I'm doing through you. Don't look at what I will do in and through you. The Lord says, just be still and know that I am He. Just drink my presence in. Just focus on me. Just worship me in spirit and in truth. Leave your water pots. Leave the things that you think can bring you any satisfaction. I am the one. And the Lord says, it doesn't mean that I will not do this and not do that. The Lord says, as you seek me and my kingdom, I will add all those things unto you. So lift up your hands and say, I draw. I thirst. I'm desperate for you. More, Lord. More, Lord. I worship you. I receive all that you are. Remove every hindrance. What do you want, my Lord? What can I give you? Oh, precious Lord, draw me.